Yesterday, the Speaker of the House of Representatives, Femi Gbajabiamila, compared Yoruba agitators and IPOB to Boko Haram and ISWAP. What's your reaction to this?
Well, if the Honorable Speaker of the House of Representatives can compare ISWAP, the Boko Haram, with Yoruba self-determination agitation and IPOB, I see that as unfortunate and a reckless statement on his part. And you see, this has further shown the deceit of the Buhari-led APC government. It's very clear where they have failed on several occasions to call a spade a spade. The same government that refused to call the Fulani killer herdsmen that the UN acknowledged as the sixth most dangerous terrorist organization are the ones now labeling self-determination activists as terrorists. What they failed to realize that no government, no power can stop an idea whose time has come. Self-determination agitation is attractive in Nigeria today because of the contradictions in the system, particularly the unprecedented nepotism exhibited by the Buhari presidency. It is very clear, and you cannot gag a people. The Yorubas were known for their frankness in fighting for their fundamental right as a people. Even it started when the colonialists came to take over our land and to lump us together with other nationalities in what now became in Nigeria, which Obafemi Awolowo called a mere geographical expression. Nobody can blame those who are agitating, which I'm one of and part of, clamoring for the self-determination of the Yoruba or the Igbo Federation or what they call Biafra. When the leaders sustain the divide and rule policy of the British colonialists, who consciously manipulate the leadership of the different nationalities that formed Nigeria against themselves, so that Nigeria will not attain the question of nation building, nationhood, because Nigeria remains a state that is made up of several nations forced together. And from independence till date, those who took the mantle of leadership from the British colonialists do not make any concerted effort for Nigeria to be a nation. They consciously sustain their own influence and power through appeal to promote their interest of ethnicity, tribalism, and religious affiliations. They capitalize on what divide the people to manipulate and win power for themselves, not for their people. For instance, there's this clamor that power must shift to the south. But our continuous experience has shown that those, the so-called power shifting to the south, that one or two elements will be manipulated into power in the name of the 4 years periodic election. When the ruling caste impose one of them on the people, that person, they will now claim, represent that ethnic nationality or the geographical location. Me, I don't see how a Buhari government translates to the development of the entire North, aside the fact that he is consciously biased and supportive of all the criminality perpetrated by the Fulani hegemons. And that is why we said his nepotism is clear And it's one of those things that influence the agitation for either Biafra or Odua Republic. Nobody can convince me that an Oshibaju represents the yearnings and aspiration on a Fanavu Ridge, Yoruba man.
Now, Comrade Balogun, why is the current structure, I mean, beyond the concept of the fact that Buhari is Nepotistic, why is the current structure called Nigeria not working for any of the interest groups?
Nigeria cannot work because, you see, the British, when they were leaving power, they consciously handed over power to the most backward section of the Nigerian ruling class, the reactionary. Those people that lacks the vision to move Nigeria forward. And that is why you see, Awolowo is still regarded as the best politician, the most visionary politician that has ever come out of what we call Nigeria today. Because of what he has been able to do. It's on record, it's historical, and nobody has been able to beat that he was the one, Nigeria, the Yoruba, when Awolowo governed the Western region, Yoruba, they were exposed to television. Even before some European countries today, we have not seen somebody that look into the future, that projected into the future so that at least future government can build on. We don't see that. You see, rather than a Tafa-Baliwa government having such consciousness, they were more concerned about weakening the power and influence of an Awolowo in the Western region. And you see, at a time that the Northern region is bigger than the West and Eastern region combined, they still find it pertinent to divide, to balkanize the Western region into Western region and the Midwest. It is not to achieve any altruistic something towards development or nationhood, but to work in that so that at least they will be able to continue to govern or misgovern the Nigerian state. We lack visionary leadership, and that is why most often than not, people attributed the problem of Nigeria to that of leadership. But the problem of Nigeria is beyond the question of leadership, because the neocolonial nature of the Nigerian state is what is killing us. And that legacy was a colonial legacy. It is conscious on the part of Britain, so that at least they give us flag independence. They will continue to administer and control our economy through the post leadership that we have been having since independence. They imposed the first one, and they ensure that if you want to lead Nigeria, if you want to be the president of Nigeria, without the consent of certain Western influence, you cannot be.
Now, comrade, some Yoruba scholars have rejected the call for the Yoruba agitations or secessionists, describing the fact that Oduduwa Republic cannot fly high because of the deep-seated prejudices among the micro-ethnic groups in the Yoruba, what is your view about this?
Who are the scholars? They are speaking for themselves. Scholars that do not identify with the problems, with the pangs, with the pains daily experienced by the Yoruba. So, you see, scholarship has to do with application of your knowledge to what is happening in your immediate environment. All these ones that are doing research and that are consultants of the ruling class, they are consultants of those who has contributed to the regional state of Nigeria in one way or the other. So what do we expect from them? They have to find all means necessary to protect their cooking pot. And that is why they want the sustenance of Nigeria as presently constituted. If Nigeria has been what it's supposed to be, Nigeria has the potential not only to be a giant of Africa. Nigeria is presently, according to Joe, okay, if you remove the G in Nigeria being a giant, Nigeria remains a hand. So Nigeria is a hand. And those people, they were happy because they were able to amass wealth to build mansions, in fact, at the expense of the majority that wallowed in abject penury. Recently, the Buhari government were telling the world that he has been able to bring on Nigerians, 70 million Nigerians, beyond above poverty level. But the reality is that more and more Nigerians are sinking into abject poverty. Many cannot feed themselves. So where is the where are they coming from? How do the so-called scholars gauge the mood of an average Yoruba person that cannot feed in a day? And they knew that the political class in Yoruba land are misrepresenting them. Today, if you go out around the street, since Gbajabiamila made his unfortunate remark yesterday, they were cursing him because they see him as somebody who wants them to remain a slave under the perpetual control of the Fulani. So what are we not talking about? They are not speaking our interest. If the so-called scholars, if they are not self-opinionated, they should support the clamor for a UN supervision of a national referendum. At least we know the ruling class in Yoruba land, particularly our politicians, that the process has been so monetized that at least they will try to buy votes. Let them come and try it with their influence. If they know they are in control and they have the money to buy the to buy the feelings and something of the people, they should support. It is very clear. Let us go to the field. Let the UN come to supervise a national referendum. Their whole something is that Nigeria should be restructured. We are saying that Nigerians has no hope, that we have passed that stage, that Nigeria should become balkanized. It has to be balkanized. If they call it secession, let it be secession. We cannot be slaves in our land. A government that's supposed to focus on other things that will make life more meaningful on the level of the people, are you posing certain, are you posing the question of gracing roots? That is what the government, the government has reduced governance, the question of serving the interest of a particular set of people, particularly the elders, and all these things that they are saying they are giving loans, they are given to farmers. Which farmers are they giving this to? I read recently that the government gave over 16 million people about 10,000 naira on a monthly basis. Where are those people? They should come up with the statistics. We should know people who are benefiting, local government by local government, area by area, state by state. You see, they cannot continue to fool the people all the time. They can fool people sometimes, but it cannot be all the times.
Now, still on that, let me quickly get your perspective on that. The federal government, as a matter of fact, came out with this integrated farm estate, which is still being rejected.
It's a ruga in another sense. It's a ruga. It's a question of obesity is sing a song that they carried a cow through the window. That is that Agbe Balu go through window. It is like carrying a cow. You're passing a cow through the window. After the rejection, after the imposition of the rejection of Ruga, that is why a Buhari government come up with that one as an alternative to anti-open grassing legislatures being passed by the southern governors. And in fact, to equally show that even the southern governors were not equally genuine about their something. Because the open grass of anti-open grass legislation has to be enforced. And you see, they are disparity from state to state. We have some said 20 years, a state like Osun is talking of the penalty is here. You know, just all of them were doing this to still please the Fulani federal government of Nigeria. You don't have the security apparatus to enforce your laws. They created Amotekun in the southwest. The federal government refused them. Being armed, we harassed the ISBA, the Islamic police. Security police and they carry sophisticated weapons. They even have the audacity to arrest policemen. We are not on the same page. That is what we are saying. From all intent and purposes, we are not on the same page. On the same page. The people that ban the question of manicure that is used to advertise clothes and whatever, that ban it. Whereas we used it, it is acceptable to us in the South. We don't want a situation whereby people will impose a religion on us. We don't want a situation whereby people will kill and maim people in the name of a God. Those are the differences that we are talking about.
Let's look at the issue of insecurity in the land, and we've had cases of banditry, headsmen killing them. This threats continue unabated. Why is the government, Buhari's regime, continue to fail in this regime?
What we experience and is going on is state-sponsored terrorism. If not, the Nigerian state, the Nigerian army, has the capacity, has the capability to crush any form of insurgency wherever and whenever it arises. Look at this speed through which they call the so-called gunmen menace in the Southeast, whereas they treated the so-called bandit with kid gloves. A Sunday ago, for leading peaceful protests all over Yoruba land, they went to his house, not to arrest him, but to kill him. That is why they killed some of his lieutenants. He was fortunate to escape. And Nigerian government degenerated to the extent of trying to extradite somebody that you tried to kill, but was fortunate to escape from Benin back to Nigeria. And the Sheikh Hamad Gumi, who has been acknowledged, arrested, and detained in the past in Saudi Arabia for terrorism-related activism and funding, they continue to abuse our sensibility that the government has to negotiate with the bandits, that they have to give them a soft landing, that they should not be called criminals, that in fact they cannot end banditry, that the bandits have devised means and ways to get out of areas presently under the bombardment of Nigerian army. This is the same man, Sheikh Gumi, that told the entire world that whenever he visited the bandit for negotiation, that it is in the know of the presidency, that the presidency gave him enough support in terms of SSS, police, and soldiers as escorts to meet the bandits. He has not been checkmated on everything that has been saying that could plunge this country into further bloodletting. So in essence, I'm saying that the federal government is sort of complicit in the crisis in terms of they have the power, they have the capacity to stop bad entry, but they fail to do so. Okay, they're telling us that some people, that some bandits, that some terrorists have surrendered. Where are they? Do we see them? Where are their weapons? Similar stories. When Nigerian militants surrendered their weapons and they were given amnesty in the past, we saw their weapons. We saw them one by one. It is not enough for us, for the army headquarters spokesperson, to read a sheet of paper that some people surrendered. Where are those people surrendered? Why are they giving them? Why are they absorbing them into the Nigerian army? These are something that is creating fears in the mind of other nationalities, that they are laying the template for an Afghanistan situation, so that I don't, will not be caught unaware. That is why we intensify the agitation for either a regional autonomy, self-determination, and social emancipation of the Yoruba within the Nigerian state, but in as much as they refuse that, then the question of standing a sovereign Oduan Republic becomes more and more attractive. And no matter the level of intimidation, arrest and killing can stop an idea whose time has come.
Finally, authorities in the United Arab Emirates actually on Monday named six Nigerians with ties to insurgent groups, Boko Haram, as terrorist financiers. And the Minister of Justice at Abuja Abulami has yet to take actions with regards to bringing to book this so-called terrorist financiers. What's your view about this? And what's the way forward for Nigeria out of this total?
You can see clearly. That is why we said, and some of us first believe, that the presidency is complicit. Now, terrorism and banditry festered. Had it been something from the south, a Malami will come out and condemn. If we want to insult the governors and any other organizations, imagine recently they were talking or thinking about not only the prescription of Afenifere, but declaring it as a terrorist organization. Whereas Malami kept silence when the likes of Ado, who was confirmed or not confirmed, the report said it's leaked in one way or the other to Mr. President. At least Nine Mobile has come out to deny the involvement of Malami. They were now playing on the pranks. Maybe Musa is one of his name or not. You see, I don't see this government arresting or prosecuting any of the six mentioned financiers of terrorism in Nigeria, because they were not only sympathetic, they believe in the cause to Islamize Nigeria and to Fulanize it. And that is why the federal government is hell-bent by any means necessary for the others to take over our forest reserve, threatening our governors who have control over every inch of the land under their jurisdiction. They want to impose grazing routes and the headers on them. Why? To be domiciled forcefully in our land. These are people that will kill and maim people. These are people that will impose their governance on them. Recently, we see what manifested in Edo. Whereas they tried to impose a sultanate on a community in Benin before it was stopped by the governor through the court. Had it been, the governor just made a blanket statement, the likes of Malami will come out to vilify him. The likes of Garba Shehu will come hard on him. But now you can see that they were silent. Whereas they invited Professor Olaomi, that said the presidency is complicit and that some terrorists and their sponsors were part of this government. They were quick to invite him. They declared him wanted. When it was exposed, they now said, yes, he was invited for questioning. Had it been that he went there with lawyers, there's probability that he would be under in a military cell by now. So we are saying, in essence, that I don't see prosecuting the so-called named financiers, and they are not. We still expect more names. More people are still complicit in this government that are part and that are funders and that they are mentors, that are mastermind of what is happening. A bandit, we read it in papers recently, that a bandit said they use military helicopters to drop arms and foods for bandits. How far have they gone in investigating such a weighty allegations? If not because of complicity, or they know There was a time that Malam Erufai said, there is practically nothing that is happening in Nigeria that the government or the presidency didn't know about. We have DSS in every nooks and cranny of Nigeria, in every local, in the 774 local government. They are collecting reports on a daily basis, and they are telling us they don't know. What makes discredited Abayi Kyari a supercop? It was because he would go to the necessary security agents to dust their files on criminality and criminal elements in each of the communities. And that's why he makes waves as a supercop. Before he was discredited in the Hush Puppy case. And if you look at the way they are going about it, there's every possibility he will not be indicted. He may be displaced out of the police. Nothing further had on the matter. So I think there is every reason. There's every reason for the right-thinking freedom lovers to support the agitation for a peaceful dissolution of the Nigerian state by the UN. It is the most peaceful panacea to save the world from an imminent war. It is the Fulani community through the Herdsmen that has started with a war against other ethnicities in Nigeria. And they were being treated with kid gloves by the Buhari-led APC government.
Comrade Wale Balogun, thank you so much for your insightful analysis.
Thanks for having me.